Hey, how's it going, guys? This is Tom from UDS with another edition of the Quarantine Sessions, where I chat to people a lot cooler than myself in this wonderful land of lockdown. So wonderful, so wonderful. The terms pioneering and iconic get bandied about way too much nowadays, but it definitely applies to my guest this week. Producing some of the most visceral, uncompromising music for over 30 years, they're back with their 16th studio album during a time when their ethically charged message is unfortunately more relevant than it perhaps it's ever been before. It is my pleasure to introduce Barney Greenway of Napalm Death.
Say anti-iconic though, Tom, if I say anti-iconic, post-iconic, if you're on there. Yeah.
I like that. So how are you doing in these strange times that we live in?
Yeah, it is strange times, but I'm actually doing all right, man. You know, I as I've told probably 100 people at this point doing interviews, I live alone, so I've only got myself to answer to. You know, I've always lived very simply anyway, so I just kind of needed to make a few more adjustments. And to me, it's been fine. You know, it's given me, in some ways, space to think. You know, it's certainly living as I do on the South Coast. You know, which is very nice. You know, I can go out in the mornings really early and take my bike, and it's just fucking great, to be honest. That really helps you, you know. It helps your whole kind of psyche, I suppose. So, yeah, it's not been too bad for me. But of course, you know, it would be nice at some point to get back to doing, you know, doing gigs and stuff with the new album coming. But you know, for now, we are where we are, I suppose. And you know,
well, that's it. I mean, you're known for being one of the most sort of the bands that tours most relentlessly over the years. So it must have been quite the culture shock to go from touring all the time to...
Thinking back to March when we did our last gig, I mean, it's in certainly in Napalm terms, it's an eternity. It's an eternity. It's almost like a couple of lifetimes, you know, usually. Yeah, I mean, but I'll be ready, you know, once we get back up again. You know, As I kind of mentioned, you know, I'm keeping myself in shape, so I'll be ready to, you know, start jumping up and down again and screaming for all my life's worth, you know, and all the rest of it. So
that's what it's all about. Because it hasn't been the worst year for you, because you're a Villa fan, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
So I mean, at least they stayed up. So it could have always been worse.
Yeah, no, I mean, I was surprised, actually. Because we have a history of shooting ourselves in the foot, you know. We're really good at it, so it's actually one of the best things that we are good at, you know. But we did it by the skin of the teeth. I was actually more gobsmacked than anything that we actually did it, you know. So, but no, it was good, you know. I definitely enjoyed it, you know. And we'll see next season, you know. Hopefully not in fucking... You know, obviously we finish above 18th place, you know.
That's all you need. I mean, I support the other team in Claret and Blue, West Ham, so I think we did your boys a bit of a favour on that second to last game.
Yeah, just a little. Yeah.
Oh, well, at least we'll both have a game together some point next year. But obviously, we're both friends here, and so I like one of the ways I like to get to know my friends just a little bit better is to ask the hard-hitting questions, and that is... If you were a type of sandwich, what kind of sandwich would you say best represents you?
I would actually say something very simple. I would say peanut butter sandwich. You know, so all vegan, great protein, you know, just a perfect thing, really. You know, in fact, I'm a big fan of the peanut butter sandwich. I do it before... some bike rides, you know. I'll most of the days I mean this sounds really fucking sad, you know, but I do oat cakes and peanut butter, sometimes I'll do peanut butter sandwich, and it really gives you the, you know, the oomph you need to get get flying down them cycle paths, you know, and terrorizing everybody else on a bicycle. You know?
Well, that's what you need. I mean, that is quite quite fitting for Napalm Death as well, because I can speak from experience. After doing half an hour on the exercise bike this morning, listening to the new album made me go that a little bit extra harder. So that's my audible peanut butter sandwich.
Yeah, we're not only helping with your sort of musical and lyrical appreciation, we're also increasing your fitness. So, you know.
Two for one. So speaking of the new album, Throes of Joy in the Jaws of Defeatism, it's out in just over a week, if I'm correct, dropping September 18th.
Yeah, something like that, yeah. Mate, you ask me, I don't know.
Well, what can people expect from this release that perhaps may be different from previous releases?
I mean, it's just, to be honest, quite simply, it's a couple of steps along. You know, it's really that. You know, I mean, Napalm has never really stood still, stood in one place at one time, because we were always of the mindset, why repeat yourself? You know, what's the point in making the same album twice? You know, you're not challenging yourselves. And for a lot of people that follow your band, usually, probably not really challenging them either, you know. So yeah, it's just a couple of steps onwards, you know. It brings in a lot of the influences that are always there, but not arguably not always as recognised as the basic grindcore touchstones, you know. So there's kind of the post-punk alternative aspects, like, you know, Killing Joke, Swans, Joy Division, Birthday Party, My Bloody Valentine, all this different stuff. Young Gods, it's all there, you know. So there's just a plethora of all these different things, you know, amalgamated. And it feels like a very fulsome album to me, you know, sort of looking with hindsight, even this early on, you know, it seems there's a lot to get your teeth into, I think, you know.
Well, that's interesting that you say that, because the latest single, A Belly Full of Salt and Spleen, which is the closing track of the album, it feels like it's designed to sort of have that lingering after effect, because obviously it deals with some really harrowing and sadly very pertinent themes. But it's also with this track, I was reading that there was a lot of experimentation that went into the percussion of that. Tell us a little bit about how all that came about.
Yeah, so basically, I wasn't there when it happened, but I could totally see. I kind of knew it was going to happen because I'd already been tipped off. But like, so basically, Shane and Russ, the producer, they found just a load of junk outside around the studio, and they just built a drum kit, you know, from like oil cans and rubbish bins, and they use like screw heads for cymbals and stuff. I mean, this is, other bands have done it throughout, like Einsturz and Neubarten, a German band, who, if you, I don't know how people are aware of that band, but they were the ones that used like angle grinders and stuff to make, you know, music. So we get totally excited by that kind of avant-garde sort of thing. So like Shane was really, like, at that point in time, he was really sort of experimenting with electronics. But he was like, you know what, I want to build some physical stuff that we can really fuck around with, you know what I mean? So they just found some bits in the, like, where the studio is, it's quite, it's a little bit rural. So I think they just found some old junk piles that were out the back, and they just literally built percussion and drum kits out of that, and like bashed the fuck out of it, you know. And that, so a lot of the stuff you can hear on the track is just that, you know.
Absolutely. And I mean, I think it definitely goes a long way, because although by letter of the law, it's probably one of the more sort of melancholic, softer parts of the album. If there ever was a softer moment on a Napalm Death album. But I think, as you say, the themes and the production behind it makes it particularly heavy in the more sort of thematic sense.
I would say it's still harsh and abrasive. Mm. You know, I mean, it's very grim, very very, very melancholy in some ways. But if you listen to the bass note is fucking insane. I mean, it's noisy as fuck, you know. So that really sort of brings the nastiness out of it, sonically speaking, you know. So it's definitely not it's definitely not lightweight, you know. It's definitely a very, you know, grim track. And I think when I heard it, it just, the vocals that I do on that track, I was just like, yeah, this is going to be perfect. You know, it's kind of one of the bands I mentioned, Swans, like Michael Jara. It's complete, basically what he would do, you know, back in the 80s, 90s. And it was just very fitting to me, you know. So I took that and I flexed the vocal muscle a little bit. So there's quite a lot of vocal notation in that song, which I was quite pleased the way it turned out, you know, definitely. So.
And you say that, you know, there isn't really a respite on this album. It is pretty much in some shape or form pure aggression almost all the way through the album. I would say from my listening and from my perspective, probably more so than 2015's Apex Predator. Do you think there was like a, you know, a conscious reflection on the state of the world that brought about this new theme?
Mate, the world's always been shit. But don't get me wrong, you know, when I say that, it has its very bright spots, you know. There's always like some bright spots, but you know, underneath that, there's always been some like really fucking, you know, the inability for human beings to understand what humanity is, like this far into the records of our time on this earth, is fucking staggering sometimes, you know what I mean? We don't learn lessons, you know, from the past. So yeah, I mean, it was, the thing is with Napalm is we don't write generic, just provocative ideas. You know, it's got to be specific, because unless you have a hook that people can hook onto, you're going to lose them after a bit, you know, because just as an example, you know, anybody can write an anti-war song. Yeah, anybody can write a generic anti-war song. Mm. But if you're going to do that, make it specific to something, things that are going on around the world at that time, you know, so people have something they can look at and think about for themselves, you know. So, so going back to the actual like subject matter on this album, so it's about dehumanization and discrimination and separation out of like groups of people, you know. So I use two examples in across the interviews, you know, LGBTQ plus people, refugees, which is very, you know, sort of topical right now, but it also could be Romani gypsies, you know, it could be people with physical or mental disabilities, you know. The thing is that there are, discrimination has always been there. It's always been there since time immemorial, you know, whether we like it or not. But it's moved on a couple of steps in recent times, because now governments are using this kind of language and using this kind of, you know, this sort of expression. You know, there are, you know, there's, I'm loath to kind of mention it really, or mention this particular person, but you go across the Atlantic, you know, and part of his whole shtick is separating people out so he can he can discredit them, you know, dehumanize them in some respects, and, you know, discriminate against them. In Europe, we've got governments who are formulating policy on this stuff. You know, we've got governments in Europe that are proclaiming LGBTQ plus areas of cities. You know, yes, we'd have no gay plague in this, but I mean, this stuff's fucking insane, you know. It's like, so, I mean, the point being is that there's a real note of warning, you know, that there should be warning sirens going off with this stuff, because this is the way that, if you look at the 1930s, it started with like discrediting people, then it went to dehumanization of people, then it went to aggression on the streets, you know, and physical sort of physical like repellence, you know. And now, and the next step on from that, of course, is like mass murder, you know, which we saw in the 1930s. And, you know, people say to me, oh, you know, you're making too much. The parallel is the difference is too big, you know, between then and now. Well, to be honest, that's how it started, you know, in those times. And, you know, the tactics that were used by very, very charismatic people, you know, to carry that forward, to establish power and to establish control. You know, it's only a couple of steps onwards from what we're seeing now until we see some pretty serious stuff. And, you know, in some places in the world, it's already happening. You know, you look at a place like Chechnya, where it appears that, like, gay people are disappearing completely, you know, from life. Their families, you know, they're just disappearing off the face of the earth. And there are suggestions that there is a culling of gay people from the population, you know, within, you know, I mean, that's where things go, you know, from the stuff I've been talking about. So I think people should be very concerned, you know, and if humanity counts for anything, you know, this stuff needs to be, it needs to stop. You know, we need to, again, you know, we need to understand what being a human being actually means. It means treating your fellow human being, no matter what their lifestyle is, you know, and I use that very loosely when I say lifestyle, what their whole biological preferences are in life. This is another human being, you know, it's somebody that's standing across from you. There's no threat to anybody else from that, you know. So
I think the most scary thing is the sense of apathy that can be born out of, you know, especially if in the UK, in sort of personal experience, being in a sort of a climate where it feels like your voice is being more and more marginalized, both in office and across many facets. It's becomes even more imperative and vital to have musicians and artists such as yourself that really do sort of provide this platform that wakes people out of complacency. Because I think that's, as you say, back then and now, I think that's where the real worry lies. It's not that evil people exist, it's that people just don't care that they exist and they'll just turn a blind eye.
Yeah, I mean, I don't use the term evil, you know, because that's subjective and that actually starts to give things a mythological status, you know, because you took good and evil, you know, two moral concepts. It's not, I think you have to be a little bit careful about that, you know, but not you personally, I'm talking generally, you know, but I just think that, you know, that the thing about napalm is that we're not hitting people with big sticks, you know, we're not sort of, we're not thought police or nothing like that. It is our role, I feel, to take the ideas, put them on the table, and people can either come into it for the music alone, no problem with that. They can come in and see the ideas and, like, throw them around a little bit, and if it's not for them, then that's fine. But hopefully, you know, which is my preference, of course, they will take the ideas and it will maybe influence them in certain ways, you know, to the way they view things and the way they react to things and stuff. So I'm hoping that that's the case, you know, because it would actually be very contradictory to start being dictatorial, to start trying to formulate a dictatorial sort of a way of getting the ideas across. That's not the object of the exercise, you know. So
very interesting. It's very interesting. But yeah, I mean, I can say from my own experience that being introduced to yourself, I'm probably going to show my age or lack of, but being introduced to you by my father, I've become more aware of its significance as it goes along. And it's interesting how, as you say, I first got into Napalm Death for the music, and then it's sort of only in hindsight that the message has sort of permeated through, and it has helped to shape my worldview. Not to say that, you know, I was sort of that mindset anyway, but in just in the way that I think and sort of, you know, process reality, it really does have an effect. And so, you know,
well, that's very kind of you to say so. But, you know, the thing is, mate, you're always, you know, people always talk about this thing about the great thinkers, Well, my response to that would be, well, anybody can think, you know, it's a biological, chemical thing that we've all got, you know, and no one method of thought process is better than the next. You know, it's just thought process. You know, that's what it is. I guess my point being that everybody will formulate their own ideas. You know, Napalm is there to enhance, you know, and perhaps divert sometimes, you know. It's not there to, well, I think it would be unreasonable to think that the whole raft of Napalm ideas would completely shape a person in a particular direction, because you have to formulate your own thoughts first and then take things from there, you know. So again, I would say that it's not that if Napalm was to be this dictatorial band that, you know, trying to say, well, this, you know, all those things you've ever been taught, wrong, and hit some, you know, imagine like a school desk is hitting somebody, and then that's not the, you know, we would be completely sort of contradicting everything that we've ever said to do that, you know. So not, of course, contradictions are a part of life, no problem with that, you know, but not to that degree, you know. So
there's quite a few different vinyl pressings for the new record, including some of my favourites that I was reading about. Germicide Yellow, the swirled vinyl, and Stressed Sanguine Blood Smear. Did you have a personal favourite pressing of the new album?
Well, you know, I wrote all those subtitles for the thing. You know, I wrote all of them. You know, fucking hell, my head was coming off. After I did about 20... versions of vinyl across Europe and America and different places, and I was trying to come up with all these quirky kind of references, you know, with the color and the of the vinyl and the general thrust of the ideas and the lyrics and stuff. Fucking hell, I had to go and have a lie down after all that, you know. But no, I just, you know, it's kind of meant to be an entertaining thing in some ways, you know, and a little bit quirky and stuff. So I can't even remember half the stuff I wrote, to be honest. Cause like I say, I took a great big fucking lie down after I'd written all them, you know. So yeah, they were hopefully, because I like to, my whole thing about Napalm is I will put as much into it as I can. You know what I mean? I everything's got to be 100%. There's no 50% with Napalm. So, you know, there's more of an more and more of an emphasis on coloured vinyls like nowadays. So I was like, you know, rather have the actual colour. I mean, it sounds a bit dull, you know, and I can like jazz it up a little bit. So that's what I did, you know.
It's the little touches that make it all the more special. But yeah, I've still got to pick mine. I think I'm going to probably go for Stressed Sanguine Blood Smear, get it imported from America, because it's got the vibe I'm looking for. But anyway, as we're running it short on time, I will ask you, what song are you most looking forward to playing live whenever we can play live again off the new album? That is,
mate, I will always struggle to pick a song. You know, I fucking hell, I just can't. You know, I've been asked this question relating to other releases like loads of times, and I just can't pick one, you know. So I'll give you a couple. I would say Backlash, Just Because. I would say Amoral. I would say Throes of Joy in the Jaws of Defeatism. I would say, if it's possible, Belly Full of Salt and Spleen. It's going to be a tricky one, that one, because it's going to need, I mean, obviously from the sound of it and all the layers of stuff there, it would be really great if we could play it live, you know, but I don't know how possible that's going to be, certainly straight from the off, you know. So so yeah, there's a few for you. There's probably others and I just can't think of them right now, but
Well, hopefully it won't be too long before we can, you know, all start touring again. But I don't hold my breath all that much. But
we'll see.
But anyway, the one question that we always end with is we are Upside Down Shark. And as I said off the recording, still no idea why we're Upside Down Shark. We're in way too deep to change it. But with that in mind, what is your favourite shark? And it can be real. It can be fictional. It could be something from a movie or a TV show or something from nature. I mean, I don't think we've had whale shark before, so you would be the first if you wanted to throw that one into the...
Yeah, let's say whale shark. I'd say beautiful creatures, but all sharks are, you know. And I do want to say as well, obviously there's this whole narrative about sharks being an object of fear, and they shouldn't be, you know what I mean? They should not be, you know. They are as beautiful as the next creature, and they are just operating within their own evolutionary and... you know, and their own ecosystems, you know. And they, like, again, much like other things, you know, the treatment of them from human beings sometimes is just unfathomable to me, you know, the way they are sort of not only hunted, but, you know, driven out of certain places, you know, for human, in preference to humans. And, you know, I just think it's just fucking atrocious, to be honest with you, sir.
Unfortunately, it is. But if you haven't heard of them before, I definitely recommend checking out the UK Shark Trust. They're sort of the big shark-based charity based in the UK.
I know the UK Shark Trust, yeah.
We try to do a little bit for them every year because, they gave us our name, so it's the least we can do is try and help them. So, they're a great charity. They do some great work.
Brilliant. Yeah, I'm all for that. Double thumbs up from me, yeah.
Well, speaking of great work, obviously the album is fantastic, and I just have to say thank you so much for your time today. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting to you.
No problem at all.
And hopefully maybe sometime in the future, whenever we can all be in the same room again, we could do this in person. That'd be an honour.
No, never a problem.
Awesome. And for anyone listening at home, make sure to pick up Throes of Joy and the Jaws of Defeatism out September 18th, we think. Wherever you find good music.
You know better than me, you know. Yeah.
We'll put all the links to everything you need to know in the description below, and obviously do all the normal YouTubery stuff. Hit subscribe, like, share, I don't care. And we'll see you next time.